Lord to see what the Lord has in store for us.
Thank God, appreciate us talking with you today.
Amen. Good to be seeing you in a minute.
Good preaching here a little bit.
I thank God for you being here, visitors. All right, what we're going to do is turn to page 58.
I might give you the wrong number.
56.
I've done those too many times. I'm sorry.
Page 56 in the hymn book. Page 56. When we all get to heaven, let's stand and we sing today. First, second, and last verse.
Let it go!
you have a good time in the Lord today. You just thank God. Or get out yourself home with this country folk. We just worship the Lord. That's just all we need. No more, no less. I tell you what, I like folk that like to come to church. I tell you what. Yeah. A lot of folks, you know, I heard a preacher say the other day, it makes a lot of sense. A lot of folks go to church, they worship the church, but they don't worship the God of the church.
That's right.
That makes a big sense. That a lot of sense, don't they?
Yeah, for
good to be here today. Appreciate you coming this morning. And we're going to get to some tacos. I tell you, if you got an offering, something you want to put in, you step up here and put it in the mic while they're getting ready to sing. Y'all come on, get anything to do with it. Ain't it good to be here today?
Amen.
The Lord held the rain off of us.
Yeah, praise the Lord.
If you listen to me, they say that.
Don't mess up.
From land, there is a friend.
Yes.
Yeah. still choose to serve the Lord faithfully. But I cannot begin to imagine what He has in store.
Forgiveness for every mistake. Yes.
And I have you homecoming. What did you say, 30?
34.
34 years. Lord. That's awesome. That's Amen. A wonderful thing.
Amen.
And we're glad to be here. If you don't know, how many has ever heard us? Never heard us before? Everybody's known us, huh? Well, I'm glad we got some new songs this year. It's a Sunday talk with old ones, you know, but it's always good to have some new stuff every time we go. Of course, on my far side there is Abby, Kitty, I'm Leslie, and my son Shepherd, and my mama back there, Miss Phyllis, and my husband Chris. You're going to see and hear him in just a little bit. But we're here to worship Jesus.
Amen.
Amen.
And we try to encourage you folks.
Yes.
And I tell you what, this song right here is going to get you going.
Amen.
Because I know it's mine.
Yeah. Amen.
There are so many battles.
Amen. Bless you.
gospel way is sometimes hard, but this old world is not our home.
That's right.
We'll soon see Jesus. We'll sing our song.
just kind of thinking of that one. That's an old one I was going to have her do, but she can't. She's getting old too, so she can't remember like me. Can't remember the words. But let's see, let's do this. It says, I like songs that speak to my heart. If they speak to me, I hope they'll speak to you.
Amen.
She turned the mic off, okay? I'm not a Ukraine. I'm not a singer, but you know, there's some people that can sing, and other people think they can sing.
Yeah.
And I'm probably one of those. I love to sing. I think we have a song. I think I preached maybe the first time I was here, the Jesus song. I don't remember. I preached that several times. Is that people will rob you of your song.
Yes, sir.
And the devil will replace your song with Achy Breaky Heart, Watermelon Crawl, and all the rap songs and jungle songs, R&B. But we've got a. This is probably my theme song. I've been singing for years. It's called My Sins Are. It's more entertaining than anything, I guess, and prayerful, because you say bless them. I'll do the best I can. I got my words here.
Chris, family. What a blessing. I appreciate them, appreciate him being here this morning. I did really be honest with you when I found he had a bypass surgery effects on March 4th. And I didn't know whether he'd be able to be here today, but he is.
Praise God.
Thank God for Brother Chris, and I'm willing to come today and he can preach.
Bless him.
You hear? And also, too, we're going to come back here at 1:30, 2 o'clock to have some more singing, okay?
Y'all
come back. Everybody, I encourage you all, if you visit her, please stay and eat with us.
Yeah.
Come back and sing if you can. You're welcome. It's a Brother Chris.
You can eat my fried chicken.
Amen.
God bless you.
I love you. God
bless
you.
Amen.
All right, Psalms chapter number 40, if you have your Bibles, your King James Bible, amen.
Amen.
Psalms chapter 40. I come in this morning anticipating preaching a different message, and it shifted a little bit, and I hope that this will be an encouragement to you. Psalms chapter 40, King David is writing. If you're familiar with the text, most of you are. And if you're not, then we'll get to it in just a second. But in lieu of reading the text, I want to just tell you a little history about my life. And I've been at Bible Baptist Church for this December. It will be 23 years.
Amen.
As pastor, we came back in, I guess, 2000. And when we moved there, we moved from Myrtle Beach, South Carolina. I was assistant pastor. We moved up and we took the church and we moved into the former pastor's double wide. And we moved to that. It was a big double wide. It was a newer double wide, but it was sitting cockeyed on the road. They didn't put it in there straight. They put it in sideways, and it was a dirt road. Anyway, we didn't really like it. We were going to buy it, right? We were going to buy it, take it off the preacher's hands, and be a blessing to him. But then we found out that that preacher had run up a bunch of bills, and he wanted me to pay for all his bills on top of that. So we didn't do that, and so we moved. Have you gone removed?
Oh,
we moved. We moved into a 35-foot RV.
Yeah.
It wasn't even a rear pusher. It was just a gas, I think. It wasn't even a diesel. But next to the church, Abby was still in Leslie's belly. Keely was about 4 years old, and it was amazing. We just roughed it for a while. And in that 35-foot RV, didn't even have a septic tank. I just dug a hole. Amen. We had volunteer tomato plants and volunteer watermelon. You know, depending on what we ate.
Yeah.
Amen. Loosen up a little bit. It's all right. So we lived there for a little while, and God opened the door. We didn't want to stay there. Did you move somewhere? You just want to stay?
Yeah.
We didn't want to stay there. And so we prayed about it. And God opened the door. We knew somebody from a previous church that owned a double wide dealership. He let us order one, and then a guy in our church let us borrow money from him, and God just worked it out. We moved to that double wide and bought a piece of land and set it up. We lived there for about 8 years, but still, Leslie wasn't satisfied then. Leslie wasn't satisfied. She, it was a brand new double wide. She picked out the colors, picked out all the little details and stuff. So after about 8 years, she got one of those little magazines, those Realtor magazines. You know, there's things of the devil prints, you know. She got one of those things, and she was looking through that, looking for a stick-go house. She wanted to be in a stick-go house. I was satisfied. I'm like a lot of men. I'll just go ahead and put y'all under the bus with myself. We can get comfortable. We just get at ease. And I was all right. Just leave me alone. Give me the remote control and a recliner that works, and I'll be all right. And some fried chicken back then. Now it's baked chicken with no salt. But anyway, so she said, I found a house. I found a house. And I'm like, well, what do you mean? She showed me the pictures, and I flipped through the pictures, and it looked like it had hardwood floors. It was two-story, had a garage, and I thought, you're out of your mind. There's no way that I'm going to be able to afford, we're going to be able to afford this house on an independent fundamental Baptist salary. Can somebody get a witness? Independent fundamental Baptist preachers do not make as much as other people.
Right.
Except for this, Brother Chapman, this year. He makes $3-4 million a year. But Leslie, I have to say, Leslie prayed about it more than I did, but she sought out God, she prayed, and I prayed some, I'm sure I did, I guess, at least it sounds good, but prayed. And you know what happened? That house was under foreclosure. The Lord heard our cry, and we were able to buy that house and then rent the house we're moving out of to a preacher friend of mine that needed a place to stay at the time. And so our mortgage was cheaper moving into a bigger house in a different location than it was. And then we were able to sell the house to members of our church at a lower cost too. But God kept moving us. He kept moving us. We didn't stay in the same place. Now that's physical movement. That's the furniture. I know when I was a young preacher and we first came to Bible Baptist Church, I thought for a while that I wasn't called to be the pastor. I don't know if this was like you too, but it seemed like everybody else was moving their furniture. They called the preacher.
Yeah.
Is that right? Yeah, you got, hey, you ain't doing nothing. You're just a pastor of the church. Come help me move my furniture. And that's why my back hurts today, because I've helped her. But I've learned over the years, I said this the other night, I've learned over the years, it's easier for you to move your membership than my furniture. Can I get a witness? So if you get mad at me, don't get mad at him. But you know, the Lord was working with us. God was working in our life, and He's trying to work in your life to move. We get so settled in our life. We can get complacent. We can get melancholy. We can just get apathetic. All those big words, those $5 words that I don't even know how to spell.
Yeah.
In church, you can love God, but yet God's trying to move you, not necessarily physically, maybe a little closer.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
I'm going to tell you, I guarantee you, you start charging $5 a seat for the back rows, you can pay off a new building. Amen.
Yeah. Yes.
Same way in our church, too. We ought to want to move spiritually, though.
Sure.
Have you moved spiritually lately? Yeah. Has been a time in your life you can really say that I have moved spiritually? Or are you at the same place you were 10, 15 years ago? Or maybe a year ago? Or should we move even from last week or even yesterday, be moving closer to the Lord? You remember that old, some of you younger or older people remember that TV show, "Well, I'm moving on up to the sky." I got your attention now. Y'all like the Jeffersons, amen. They went from the bottom, from the basement to the penthouse. They wanted to live up on high. Amen. I believe us as believers, hey, it's not necessarily where we live physically, but it is some importance to how we live spiritually. And God wants to move us. And here we look at the scriptures. If you want God to move you, you have to want to move. And here's the problem. A lot of people just don't want to move.
Yeah.
And I know we're more in a country setting. Where we're at, we've got people that move all the time because it's a place that people escape to. It's the beach.
Mm-hmm.
They think, well, I'm going to escape the Sanford, North Carolina. I'm a refugee, escapee, retiree, or flunky. I'm going to go to the beach. And they stay a year or two, and they think, what in the world have I done? And they move back home or do whatever. But sometimes when you live in inland, and you can be on mom and daddy's farm and all that, you live there all your life. But what about spiritually?
Yeah.
What about spiritually? You have to want to move spiritually. And some people say, I wish I was as spiritual as brother so-and-so or sister so-and-so. Well, that's a choice that you have to make.
Yes,
and if you want to become more spiritual, you want to get closer to God, then guess what you have to do? You have to move.
Right.
If you want to move, God has to have freedom in your life. Listen to our motivation on how we move from a barren basement to the penthouse of praise in Psalms chapter 40. Why don't we stand just for a moment? I have been sitting a long time. Your honey might even be getting sore there. We'll be sitting until noon, I'm sure. Amen. And if y'all shout a little bit, it might be about noon 30 before we get out here. I don't know. If you sit there like a funeral, we get out here in about 10 minutes. But listen to what David said, the psalmist. I waited patiently for the Lord, and He inclined unto me and heard my cry. Just stop for a second. Here's the man after God's own heart that needed to cry. He needed to holler out. He needed to ask God for something. He was in a position. Just because he had position, just because he was an authority, he had money, he had everything he wanted, he was still in a bad place. In verse number 2, he declares what that place is. He brought me up also out of a horrible pit, out of the miry clay, and set my feet upon a rock, and established my goings. And he hath put a new song in my mouth, even praise unto our God. Many shall see it and fear, and shall trust in the Lord. Blessed is the man that maketh the Lord his trust, and respecteth not the proud, nor such as turn aside to lies. Let's pray. Father, in Jesus' name I pray that you the Spirit of God would have liberty to get a hold of us all here this morning. Lord, I pray from the visitor to the one that's been a member for years and years, the one that's not saved to the one that's been saved for years and years, that we want to move on up, and God, we would get out of the place that we're in. And Lord, as King David here was in this horrible place, this PC motel, Lord, would you help us get out of our stuck place? And we ask you, God, to just bless this day and may souls come to know you closer in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated if you want to. David was living in what I call the PC motel, the pit clay motel. But he was wanting to move from where he was, where he was living, to where God wanted to put him. Now, we all, at times in our life, live in the PC motel. Do you know the difference between a motel and a hotel? Some people don't. A motel, you enter in the room from the outside. So you go down the road, you see these little tiny motels, and they're the entry to your room is always from the outside. A hotel is a little bit nicer. You have to go into the lobby. The rooms are on the interior. Now, most of the time when you see the motels, what do you see? It'll do. They're kind of run down. They're rented by the hour. Oh my. They're nasty. They're dirty. They're cheap. They're a place that we get I'm running people off left and right. Man, I just started. I had that effect on me.
No,
at least they didn't do it while I was singing. Amen. But where David was at, he described as a horrible pit. He described it as a miry clay. Well, what is that place that you may find yourself? It's a place of loneliness. And so many people, they go to church or they have, young people, you have Instagram, Snapchat, MySpace, you don't have any of that. Not allowed to have that. You go to Christian school, amen. Amen. Yeah. MySpace. I know I'm dating myself.
Yeah.
I think y'all remember MySpace, right?
Yeah.
But anyway, we have more ways of interacting with each other today to not be lonely, but there's more loneliness going around and depression going around. David was depressed. He was lonely. He was in a place of being stuck.
Yes, sir.
And I think so. You may not be really lonely. I want you to get a hold of some of this. I want you to find your place of where these points are at. You may not be really lonely and just depressed and bottom lip dragging, but you're just stuck.
Yeah,
you're just stuck. I can't get any more spiritual. My joy is not where used to be. I'm just not where I need to be. I'm just stuck. And David was stuck. David had all the material things down. He had all the positional the desires down. He was where he wanted to be physically as far as what the outside looks in, but spiritually he was stuck. It was a place he didn't want to stay. This makes the difference in whether you grow spiritually and whether the church grows spiritually or not. He was in a place he did not want to stay. We should not get comfortable. We should not be at ease in Zion, as the Bible says. We should not get, because when you just stay in one place, it's kind of like the old car that you sit on the side of the road, somebody puts up for sale that has a blown engine, and you see it year after year, and before you long, you'll start seeing it sinking, right? You'll see, and then next thing you know, it's the weeds are up around it, the tires are half stuck in there. Y'all ever seen that? Yeah. Is that just in our neighborhood? When you do like that, it helps, amen?
Yeah.
Something like that.
Yeah.
Y'all are hungry. Is that what it is? We had to eat and come back. He was in a place of loneliness. He was in a place of being stuck. He was depressed.
Yep.
A place he didn't want to stay. It's time to move. I mean, it's time to move. A lot of people think, well, I just don't want to move. It's just so difficult. And I realize physically it's difficult. But when moving spiritually, it's not as difficult as you realize. You don't have to hire two men in a truck. You don't have to go rent a U-Haul. You don't have to bribe your friends and buddies to come down and give you a hand to load up all the heavy furniture. All you've got to do is do what King David did.
Amen.
And God will do all the moving for you.
Amen.
And all you got to do is go along for the ride.
Amen.
I like that. God.
Amen.
And you say, I get out of the pit. I get out of the clay.
Yeah.
Hey, God's going to put me on a hotel called the Rock. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. The exciting thing about this move is that God does it all. No need for all the help around. And you think, man, and that's what we do sometimes, isn't it? Some do. We say, well, man, if I'm going to get unstuck, I got to have the preacher and the deacons, and I got to have the choir's got to be singing, and this got the moon's got to be in a certain orbit, and you know all these things. Got, if I want to get more, no. Look at what King David is doing here. he shows us how to move. He waited patiently for the Lord. Notice it's not stated directly here, but David at this time had stopped blaming others for where he was at. You know why we get in the PC motel most of the time? The pit clay motel, the place that we're stuck, place of loneliness, place of depression, place that we don't want to be at, is because we want to blame everybody else for us not moving. Hey, the preacher isn't deep enough, or the singing isn't spiritual enough. Yeah. No, friend, it's not anybody else's fault where you're at than your fault. It's your fault. Hey, David started blaming himself. He stopped blaming everybody else, and he said, hey, it's me, oh Lord, standing in the need of prayer.
Yes,
I think about my cardiac. I want to blame my genetics for my cardiac problems.
Yeah.
Praise God. I did find a YouTube video that said there is genetic markers in certain people that predisposes them to heart problems. But you know what the real problem was? It was all that bacon.
Yeah.
It was all that butter. Yeah. It was all that sugar. It was all that. Hey, it was my fault.
Yeah.
And so it was David's fault. David got himself in this place called the PC motel. It's a nasty place.
Yeah,
it's human nature to blame others for our own choices.
Yeah.
David was tired of being in the nasty PC motel. He wasn't going to start blaming others. He wasn't going to start shifting that because it don't do you no good. He accepted that he was the one that checked into the place.
Yeah.
He was the one that gave his credit card, if you will, if he had one back then.
Yes,
he's the one that chose it. He's the one that decided that this is all I'm going to spend. This is all I'm going to do. And friend, we sit on the pew week after week, year after year, and you say the same thing. This is all I'm going to do. This is where I'm going to sit. I'm not going to do nothing else. And friend, you get stuck and you get sink deeper and deeper into the plague, deeper and deeper in the horrible pit, and you start blaming everybody else why the church ain't growing, why people aren't being saved.
Yeah.
And friend, it's your fault. It ain't everybody else's fault. He made a move from a place being so miserable. Even if others have caused you to live in a bad place, caused you to move, spending your time blaming them don't help. All it does is suck you dry of the energy that you need to move.
That's right.
The blame game just robs you of your energy, creates bitterness, it quenches the Spirit of God. People who are out to fault find and blame seldom find anything else to do.
Right.
That's all they do. I don't know you folks here, but I know our folks.
Uh-huh.
We've got some folks that all they'll do is they'll blame everybody else for their position.
That's exactly right.
Yeah.
Exactly
right. They'll blame the government. Oh, it's Joe Biden. Well, I wish it was Joe Biden. I really wish. You know, so I could, we could vote him out, right?
Hey.
I wish it was that. Hey, but Joe Biden's not dictating your spiritual level right
That's
now.
Right. That's right.
And you make the decision. I heard somebody say this the other day. I thought it was very wise, is that our churches are going down. They're becoming more liberal. They're letting everything in the world in.
Yeah.
They don't care about sin. And Christianity is being ridiculed and so forth. And what we need to happen to us is we need to lose everything as Christians. We need to lose our nonprofit. We need to lose, this is what he was saying. We need to lose all our freedoms. And then maybe we'll find out the true believers. Because the reason why people do a lot of what they do today, they come in and they warm the pew for a little while, once a month, once a year, twice a year, is they think you're doing God a service.
Yes,
and they're hoping that they cross themselves, get a Bible, and they whatever, humble, it's going to be all right.
That's good,
but they're stuck in the PC motel.
Yeah.
And it's and everybody knows you live there.
Yeah.
Everybody knows you're living there. Everybody knows you can tell by your stinking attitude. Amen?
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Amen.
That's good. You preach on it.
When you blame others for your circumstances, you surrender control to your future.
Yes.
Listen to young people. Listen to this. When you blame others, don't blame mom and daddy. They're just trying to do the best they can most of the time.
Right.
They're stuck too. They're living there too.
Yeah.
Hey, quit blaming everybody else and start crying out to God. Blame is just an empty excuse for moving. I can't because of my boss. I can't move because of my spouse and my schedule. And you chose every one of those. Amen.
That's good preaching, bro.
Have you ever wondered if people say, I can't go to church on Sunday, can't go to church on Wednesday because of my job? Well, didn't you choose your job?
Yeah.
Well, my wife, my husband won't let me. Didn't you choose that wife or husband?
Yeah.
Oh, my schedule won't allow me. Well, didn't you? I don't know anybody that makes the preacher's job. I mean, as a pastor, my schedule changes because people need you and so on and so forth, but we choose to do what we want to do. If you really want to do something, you find a way. When you don't, you find an excuse.
Amen.
I think that deserves an amen. One man said David had been plunged into a horrible pit, into the miry clay, out of which he could not work himself. And he says, there's nothing here either of sickness or of body or the insults of his enemies. In other words, David could not find any reason to blame anybody else. He was able to just say, it's me, Lord. It's me, O me. So we have to stop blaming others. It will not help you to blame others. We got to just suck it up.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Suck it up and say, Lord, I'm in this horrible pit, this miry clay, and Lord, I need you, I need you. And David cried out. David waited patiently for the Lord. So then David did what few do consistently. And this is important to understand. He started to emotionally contact God. What I mean by that is he just didn't say a flippant prayer. You know what a flippant prayer is? Now I lay me down to sleep, pray to Lord my soul.
Yeah.
God bless mommy, daddy. God is good, God is great. You know, let him thank him for our food. All mm-hmm. Just little flippant prayers that we do sometimes. We wonder why that we're stuck in the PC hotel or motel all our life, or most of our Christian life, because we don't want to have any emotion. Now, how many of you men in here were brought up, you don't cry? You don't cry as a man. Is anybody in here like that? Don't cry, nobody. So all you men that know how to cry, praise God. I'm going to try to make you cry today.
Amen.
I'm going to preach till 3 o'clock. Got to make David said, I waited patiently for the Lord, and he inclined unto me, and he heard my cry. He heard my cry.
Yes, sir. Amen.
He may have been crying with tears, but we know that he was at least emotionally passionate about contacting God. He had got to a place that no doubt when he moved into the PC motel, he was okay initially. Initially, he was all right. Initially, he was away from where all that he didn't want to do. He wasn't obligated at the church, wasn't obligated at a home, wasn't obligated as a dad or a mother, wasn't obligated as a job. But he moved in that PC hub. He was tired of it at this point. And it got to him emotionally. You ever got so tired of something that you get emotional about it?
That's right.
You got so burdened over your kids that you get emotional about it.
Yeah.
You weep over them. You cry out. You holler. You may even get angry, righteous indignation.
Yeah.
Well, David was there. This is how David was getting out of the PC motel. He was getting out of the PC motel by waiting patiently for God to emotionally contact him and not blaming other people for his problems. So many pray a few times, little prayers, empty faith, and no passion. And when they don't get their way immediately, they give up.
Yes, sir.
I've talked to people over the years, and I said, how long have you been praying about? Well, I prayed about it last week.
Yeah.
Well, I prayed about it one time.
Mm-hmm.
I've heard they said that Burlington revival a few years ago, the Burlington revival, y'all hear about that?
Yeah.
That went on for so many weeks, and hundreds of people got saved. Mm-hmm. They prayed for 11 years for revival. I've heard people that have gotten saved when they're 60, 70 years old, and the sons or daughters or moms and dads have been praying for them for years.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
So often we get stuck. So often we're locked into this PC mode. We can't see. We can't get out of it. And the reason why you can't get out of it, because you want to blame everybody else for being in there, and it's your fault. Number two, you don't want to get emotional enough about it to contact God in
that. Right.
Effectual fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much, James says.
Yes.
Tired of loneliness, tired of depression, tired of the filth, tired of bed bugs, the roaches.
Amen.
The empty relationship with God, and that's what a lot of people have.
Yeah, right.
Empty relationship
with God. Right.
Mm-hmm. They know about God. They have a form of godliness. They do not have the power thereof. They have no idea about true salvation. Their salvation understanding is when I was baptized, sprinkled when I was a boy. Well, girl, I think salvation is that, well, I believe in God, but he don't even make you tremble. And the Bible said, James says, the devils believe and they tremble.
That's right. That's exactly
you see, you're in the PC motel, don't even realize it.
Mm-hmm.
And lost people can be in the PC motel.
Yes, sir.
Saved people can be in the PC motel. It's a shame that saved people want to move back into the PC motel, but I've seen that over the years as well. Matter of fact, I walked past a preacher the other day that he pastored a church. We helped ordain him, but he decided that he wanted a younger wife. He left everything. He left 5 kids, everything.
Mm.
When he looked me in the eyes.
Yeah, James.
He moved back to the PC motel.
Mm-hmm.
Some can allow emotion to rule them to the place of being dysfunctional, and I get that. Some people can get so, I don't know if everybody's used to being shouting and praising, hollering and all that. I love it, but
yeah.
Most places are so dead that Ambulance come pick up someone sick, they carry out five or six.
Yeah.
You know, it's just so that, no, but you go to ball games, you go to something that emotionally affects you.
Yeah.
Oh, it's some a play that your kid's in, you get the grandbabies up here singing, look back, we'll get excited about that. Here, David was emotionally contacting God. He was crying out to God. He was waiting on God. And God, I'm waiting on you. I will be patient. David was patient while being emotional. How many of your tears dried up over people? I'm guilty too.
Amen.
Our tears dry up. Sometimes just say, well, let them die to go to hell. They don't want Jesus.
Oh.
You don't want you to get that. You're in a PC motel. You do
that. Well, that's good.
David was okay with when God would come with what God would do with him. And this is important to understand is that if you're wanting to get out, you're wanting to move out of the PC motel, you want to get out of this ditch, you want to get out of this miry clay, you got to be okay with where God's going to move you. Now, understand this, your move may not be real comfortable because when you're stuck in the mud, you got to do some jerking on, you got to be pulled. And David was stuck, but David was willing to say, okay, God, wherever you want to put me, I'll go. A preacher, a former pastor of mine, he said that he was at a church. He pastored about 300 people, and as a young preacher, he messed up, and as far as just ruled the church with iron fist, and they voted him out. And he said, "Well, I'll show you. I'll go pastor another church." And God stuck him on the backside of some country in the country with 30 people. And with a piano player that could play, played everything to the tune of Victory in Jesus, wasn't it? So see, how can you sing Amazing Grace to Victory in Jesus? But he had to be willing to go where God moved him.
Yes, sir.
So let me just use something simple. If God told you to move on the front pew, if he wanted to say, I want to put you on the front pew,
Preach on that,
yeah.
We have. I do a challenge every month for our church. This month's challenge is to sit somewhere different with somebody new.
No.
Do you know how resistant Bible Baptist Church has been?
Yeah.
Few people's done it. Some people are like, "Dear God, I'm not moving where I'm young. I shall not be moved. I shall not be moved." You're stuck in the PC motel.
Yeah.
And guess what? I know people that are used to cockroaches and bed bugs.
Oh, yeah.
I know people used to filth and hoarding and nastiness and rundown. And you can get used to a climate of a lack of spirituality. You get used to worldliness and used to the alcohol and used to the homosexual and the sexual perversion. You can get used to all that. That's in the PC motel.
Yeah.
There's hookers and whoremongers and alcoholics and drugs. A lot of people don't want to leave because their dealer lives next door. And a lot of people don't want to leave because their whore's next door. They don't want to leave a good PC
motel.
Right, right, right. That's good. Works, God wants you to. He wanted to move. David wanted to move. But some love that PC, that pit clay motel.
Yeah.
Are you one of those people?
No.
Some people are. I'm not trying to call anybody a whoremonger, drug user. But I tell you, we're sinners.
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
David knew that God would hear him eventually. And our emotional attitude reveals how important moving is to us. So emotional, being emotional about something. If my wife was talking about my surgery, I had a heart attack Sunday morning. I went to the hospital. It seemed like when I had gallbladder trouble, I had to quit preaching on a Sunday.
Mm-hmm.
It's something about church that's put me in the hospital, preacher.
Yeah.
I think it's more than church people.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. But my wife was emotional. Does she have a right to be? She talked about that song got her through. I was okay because I was on Dilaudid. How many of y'all know what Dilaudid is? Amen. Yeah. How many of y'all know what drugs that make you feel good are, right?
Yeah.
You can raise your hand, right? So I was doped up. I wasn't in this world. She shows me pictures of what I looked like, and I looked like death warmed over, but I was not emotional at all. I was in my PC motel, I guess, in the ICU unit. But she was emotional. Why? Because her husband, and my kids were emotional. They came in to see me, and I had all the tubes all over, all this, $500,000 worth of junk. You get emotional, your kids get hurt, your mama or daddy dies because it's something special to you. How about your own life?
Yeah.
That's good.
Our emotional attitude reveals how important moving is to us.
Yeah.
Aren't you just tired of it? Is it going to take a doctor to tell you you got cancer, quit smoking? Is it going to take a doctor to tell you that you got to have quadruple bypass to stop eating fried chicken?
Yeah.
Guess what? It's going to take a preacher to tell you that maybe you need to move in order for you to move. It might be. That's what we're here for.
Yeah. Right.
Did you know pastors and preachers aren't here to be friends? We're here to deliver mail.
Right. Right.
And sometimes the mail isn't something you want to read, but it's something you need for. Mm-hmm. When we have to wait, it conditions our heart and mind to God's will and what it's going to produce. So what was David? Why was God waiting to answer David? Why was God not just jumping on the spot? Hey, I cried out one time. Why aren't you up there? Because God was producing something in him. Patience.
Yes,
God was producing in David the ability to trust him no matter what. God was also producing that God's on God's time, not your time.
Amen, preacher. Amen.
God's on God's time, not your time.
Amen.
Isaiah 40, verse 31, you know the verse? But they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings of eagles. They shall run and not grow weary. They shall walk and not faint. And so we find and we understand this morning that, hey, I've got to just wait on God. But I've got to emotionally contact him. When was the last time you cried?
Oh, that's right. Good.
When was the last time you wept over your position, over your children's positions, over your family's position, over missionaries' kids, and the church condition, and so on, the country's condition?
Yeah, that's right.
Everywhere you look, they're promoting sex. Mm-hmm. Everywhere yeah. you look,
Amen.
Everything
Amen.
Is about sex.
Amen.
I don't need
true preacher.
Bless the Lord.
And it also was, we're winding down. Say amen there.
Yeah, amen.
David also was delivered from the PC motel by allowing God to move him where he needed to be. He allowed God. God, move me where I need to be. When God answered David, he said, verse 2, look where he moved him. He brought me up.
Yes, sir. Amen. Amen.
So that means that he was down, right?
He was down, yeah.
So how do you know you're down? Was it physical down or was it spiritual? It could have been both. He was down. He brought me up also out of the horrible pit. So he describes the horrible pit out of miry clay. And miry clay, miry is like sluggish, nasty, it's thick. It's kind of like when you guys go mud bogging, amen? You know, nasty. He set my feet upon a what?
Rock.
A rock. And he not only did that, but he established my goings. So when God moves us from the PC motel to the Rock Hotel, he not only pulls us up and out, but he establishes us on something that's solid, stable. We become stable. We're not tossed to and fro with every wind of doctrine. We're not in church one moment, out of church the next moment, in the Bible, out of the Bible. He established my goings. In other words, David's schedule was established by God Almighty.
Amen.
Now what's important to me is what God wants for me. I told our church the other day, and I preached on having the Jonah disease. The Jonah disease is running from the will of God.
Yes.
And I said, what would y'all think? Because we had Mother's Day. We had Mother's Day, and then Sunday night come, and a third of our people decided they're just going to stay home and look at their mama and TV at the same time, I guess.
Yeah.
I said, what would you do if I decided to do that? As your pastor, if I decided that, hey, it's just not important enough, I'm going to go eat lasagna with somebody, I'm going to go out to dinner, or mama's not going to be around very much longer, so I'm going to go stare at her, and you never do it. You go to mama's house, and you go watch TV while mama's in the kitchen, and you cook.
Well, that's right.
Yeah.
Amen. What would you do if I did that? Oh, you wouldn't have to preach very long. Oh, the preacher's supposed to be here. Every born-again believer is supposed to be too.
Yeah.
You know why people don't come to church when they're supposed to? Because they're in a PC motel.
Yes, yeah. Sir.
They got to guard their hotel, their motel. They got to guard Amen. Their stash. But David was willing to allow God to put him where he needed to be. He brought him up out of the miry clay, out of the horrible pit, was put on the rock, that's the Rock Hotel, and established my goings. But then he did something else. This is important too. How do you know God has brought you out of that? Hey, you're going to sing. How many of y'all, when you were first married, when you were youngins, you lived in a kind of a rough house, a rough mobile home?
Yeah.
I did. We lived on Church Street. Anything on Church Street was It was rough. It was our first house. I mean, right down the road was one of those PC motels. And it was, it'll do for the night, you know, rented it for the hour, the minute, and drugs, everything. I mean, just a mile down the road. But did you want to stay there? No. When God moved us, you know what we did? We celebrated.
Yeah.
There was rejoicing. How do you know? David says he had put a new song in my mouth. It wasn't a redoing of an old song. And God had given him something new. Unless you talk about singing new songs. Hey, the old song's fine. It's wonderful. But hey, God moved you from the horrible pit, the mire, the clay. He put you on the solid rock, Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. The rock of hell. And you got a new song to sing. A one of victory. A one of blessing. Oh, man. One of everything you need for the rest of the year.
Yes. Amen. Yes.
A new song in my mouth, even praise unto our God. And this is interesting. Many shall see it and fear and shall trust the Lord. And you think about it, if you're living in my mind's eye, I'm just thinking about living in those little strip motels, the PC motel, and you move out, and next one moves out, and next one, you know what's going to happen? Just like when they move out of your neighborhood, people start selling their house, you always ask, what am I going to move in? Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Why are they selling out? Wonder who's going to move in next? Wonder why they're moving.
Yes, sir.
You know, David's move got the attention. His demeanor changed, no doubt. Why? Because David was singing now. David was praising God now. David had not been doing that because he was in the PC motel. But now he's in the Rock Hotel. God had lifted him up and out, cleaned him off, established his going, got his schedule back right. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Love it when God's in our schedule, not just a part of our schedule. God is our schedule. And so he's singing, he's praising, and other people saw the king doing this and said, hey, there's something different about it. Hey, David moved out, and David's different. And what in the world? They said, it says they feared. Amen. That means they reverenced and they trusted in God.
Yeah.
The move took place from the pits of uncertainty to a rock of celebration.
Amen.
He moved out of the dump of life into victorious living. See, the uncertainty is a miserable place to be. Yes, have you ever thought about that?
Yes, sir, it is.
Uncertainty is a miserable place. Shepherd is with us today because my wife did not want to be uncertain about his well-being. We were going to leave him home with the dogs because we didn't drive the bus. We were just going to come up in the morning and just drive back tonight. So I said, well, just leave Shepherd. He'll ride the church bus to church, and he can let the dogs out. But Leslie had to talk with him last night in case we all die. You're all by yourself. I guess you gave him the number to the safe, I don't know. But the uncertainty, Leslie's uncertainty, she went to bed, she texted me. Said, I just don't like to leave the Shepherd. So that uncertainty moved her.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And I said, he can go. I said, the dogs would just have to wear diapers, amen? And and he's here. Do you like living in a place of uncertainty? You don't know where you're going to go when you die? I'm satisfied where we live physically right now.
Yeah.
Spiritually, God still moved me on up to the sky.
Amen.
And God's not only prepared a mansion, but he's prepared a place.
Yeah.
Are you certain you're going to be a part of that?
Right, Jake.
Are you certain you're going to be a part of that? A lot of people live in uncertainty. I don't know why pride keeps them from trusting Christ. The idea that you have to be just like me or the next guy or the next lady shouting or waving her hand keeps them from doing it. You don't have to be like any of us. You just have to want to be like Christ.
Amen.
The celebration that we see here is found in a song to be sung. And can it be that many don't want to move to the Stable Rock Hotel because they just don't want to sing? Now, that may seem trivial, but we've got a lot. I look out, I'm up on the platform where there's somebody who leads, and a lot of the men don't sing. They just won't sing. They just... Verse 4, look what it says. Blessed is the man that maketh the Lord his trust.
Yeah,
respect not the proud, nor such turn aside the lies. The move is to the Rock Hotel, King Jesus. The song is the Jesus song. The Jesus song. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. Ephesians 5:19, the Apostle Paul wrote to the church of Ephesus, says, speaking to yourselves in songs and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody in your heart to the Lord, giving thanks always for all things unto God and the Father and the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, submitting yourselves one to another in the fear of God. Hey, they had it right in the New Testament. They had it right in the Old Testament. They knew that we'd get to that place where we'll live in the PC motel. Yeah. But God said, you ain't got to live there. You ain't got to move out of there. Right. All you got to do is cry out and wait for me. Yeah. And I'll let you live there. Takes us from a place of hopeless godlessness to from a songless pit to become a witness and a teacher for Christ.
Amen.
Yes.
So many will not allow God to move them. They might move, but they just move to another pit motel.
Yes,
but we must move. Don't you think?
Yeah.
Christians, even if you're teaching Sunday school, winning people to Christ, we still have to move.
Yeah,
it is. There's, you know, there's maybe if you, in your mind's eye, you go into the Rock Hotel and you got rooms on the bottom floor. Now, you know, probably you're like me. I want a room on the bottom.
Yes, sir.
Bottom. You know, you don't want to have to climb stairs or get in an elevator. But that's not God's economy. God wants you to move on up to the penthouse. God wants you. Hey, we're so comfortable living in the foyer, in the lobby. Maybe because of the buffets around. I don't know what it is, but most Christians just stay. They'll say, God, I'm out of the PC motel. I'm in the Rock PC motel. I'm in the Rock Hotel. But I'm not going to move anywhere else. I'm not going to get into a bigger suite.
Yeah.
And I tell you, we stay in a lot of hotels throughout the year. And I like it when they get us a suite. Because it's sweet.
Yeah.
You have room. You have a chair in there.
Yeah.
Amen. Refrigerator. Amen. It's good. So we have to trust where God will move us physically and spiritually. He may move you up and out to teach and praise Him and to sing. That's what God just wants you to do. But His ways are always perfect ways. A life in the Rock Hotel is a stable life, an exciting life.
Amen.
I know, I probably shouldn't say this, but would you want to go stay in the Trump Towers? Just, you know, the Trump Tower. I've never been there. I've been in New York. I took a 3-hour tour, kind of like Gilligan's Island. And I'd like to probably just go and just see. They say that Trump Tower stuff's gold. I mean, it's just gold because he's just, you know how he is.
Yeah.
You know where, when God moves you, it's not that we need to see gold. God puts us in a place living that material things don't matter.
Right. Yeah, right.
But just seeing people get healed.
Mm-hmm.
Seeing people get healed. Our life is a place that can draw other people or push them away.
That's good news.
Our life can either draw. Our decision this morning will either help our kids get saved or help the younger soul to hell. It's our choice. Do you want to continue to live in the PC motel? It's your God will let you do it.
Amen.
He's not going to force you. It's your choice. But don't blame others. We all have a choice to start praying now and allow God to move us. So God, what do I have to do, preacher? What do I need to do this morning? What is it that you need to talk to God. It might even take some emotion. A tear maybe, or maybe your voice getting, hey, this is real. Are you ready to meet Jesus today? If you were to die right now, where would you meet Him? Are you going to go to a mansion in heaven, or are you going to go to hell?
Right, amen.
Now before you say, I don't care, you better make sure what you believe is right. Because if you don't make sure what you believe is right, you're a fool.
Yeah.
Right. You're a fool to not make sure what you believe is right and don't take you to heaven or hell or whatever. It's just, you're crazy. You believe the lie of the devil. And the devil loves for people to go to live in the PC motel. I'll try to close with this because I'm 100. I tell our school kids several times a year, over the years, this. That when you drive down Seashore Road, where our church is at, and you've been down there, there's single wide trailers everywhere. So they used to call it Tin City, because of the single wide. And there's a bunch of single wide trailers. They ain't got no underpinning. And, you know, there's junk all in the yards, and the windows are busted out. There's tarps hanging over the roof because it's just a dump, right? I said, none of y'all, when you're 16 or 18 or 20, you drive down the road and say, boy, I can't wait for moving to that place. Boy, I just can't wait. Woo! I can't wait to get it. And they say, None of y'all. Nobody ever does that. You go by the big brick house on the other street. But you know what? Year after year, I've seen kids make the same mistakes.
Yes,
they say, no, I'm not going to live there. I'm going to live here. But they don't do what they need to do in order to get to the brick. And they...